me all your might. And the prodigal son who ran, leaving his home behind. The part where the father came running to meet him. Did you say that with me on your mind? Who am I that the king of the world would give one single thought about my broken heart? Who am I that the God of all grace wipes the tears from my face and says, come as you are. You paid the price, you took the cross, you gave your life, and you did it all with me. Just knowing you call me your child is flooding my soul with unspeakable hope. Thank you, Lord, that it's me on your mind. Who am I that the king of the world would give one single thought about my broken heart? Who am I? Of a heavenly home on high, you're preparing a place where the sorrow's erased, and when I stand before you, I find all alone.
That's not true, okay?
Oh, now you're on.
It's not true. So just a couple of announcements here. First, VIP is coming. For those of you that don't know, there's a few handouts still. It's in your bulletin, but the one that's coming up is going to be September the 8th. Okay, that's VIP. It's going to be a big time. Nancy's invited everyone out, so I encourage you to try to come to that. Let's see here. It's got Jubilation and Called Out are going to be there, and there's going to be a teaching too. A lot of good food, I've heard, so it should be a good time. Let's see what else we've got here. In September, we're going to start back Wednesday night services again, and it's going to be a great time. I think, I'm not sure. You said it was going to be, the awe of God. So it should be good. Pat's going to be doing that, and encourage you to come with that. He's down here waving at everybody. Kids are, the kids are going to be in the gymnasium, so they're going to have a big time. My kids, if they're able to not be in sports and everything else we have going on under the sun, they'll have a big time doing that. So let's see, women's group, they're going to be meeting in the middle building on Friday, September the 15th at 6:30. And then that's basically wrapping it up. So I just want to start us out with Psalm 100. It says, shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generation. We're going to have a time of singing. If you could stand and join with us.
All right, y'all, this is an old song. Y'all should know it, and it's still one of my favorites, so let's sing this together.
I sing for joy at the work of your hand.
You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's been quite some time since I had this wonderful privilege, and it is a privilege, to speak in our church. My name is Jim Hogsett. In case you don't know me, I am the president and founder of a worldwide Christian organization called Worker Ministries. It's headquartered in Elon, North Carolina, where we promote the Christian work ethic throughout the world. When I was asked to speak this morning, I will tell you it took less than 20 seconds to decide on this subject, because the message that I bring you this morning is so critical that I've spoke these same words in places like the Pasadena Convention Center in California. I've spoken in Peoria, Illinois. I brought this message even to Times Square, New York City, where I spoke 4 years ago. It's that critical. Oh, there's so many people in God's world. We're just going through the motions of living. They're not living, just going through the motions. My grandmother, bless her heart, she used to describe those individuals as being those whose motto is, come day, go day, God send Sunday. It's a pitiful situation. And you meet them every day. It may be your next door neighbor. It may be someone in the church. It may be you. And so this morning I bring you this message: how to live a purpose-driven life. How to live a purpose-driven life. Now let me say this in the beginning, that this applies not only to places like the workplace, It applies to inside of God's house because this is his house. He owns it. How to live a purpose-driven life and not just spend your life. The message is so critical that at the end of the service this morning, we're going to give you a copy of it. So you won't have to worry about taking any notes. 4-page copy will be given to you because I want you to take it home, and we'll talk about that later. I want you to take it and digest it. And think about not only yourself, but others who can benefit from it, and especially our young people. So that our young people don't grow up just walking through this place called life, that they will live a joyous life as I have lived. I come to you this morning on the basis of the following foundation. Number one is the gospel of Jesus Christ, and number two is my own life. Because I have been able to, thank God for him, I have been able to lead a purpose-driven life. And that's why I've had so much joy. Oh yes, I've had my stumbles just like you have. I've had my disappointments like you have. We're all human. But I can tell you this morning, my testimony is that I have lived a purpose-driven life. And I'm going to give you that experience and tell you with a Sears and Roebuck guarantee, that's what they used to call it anyway, when Sears was on operation, I will guarantee you it'll work for your life, for your grandchildren, for your children, and whoever you share the message with, living a purpose-driven life. 6 steps to living a purpose-driven life. Number one on the list, find your calling. Find your calling. God says that long before he created Jim Hogsett, long before he created you, I had plans for you. Plans for you to serve me. Plans for you to prosper. That's God talking, live and direct from heaven. He has told us that. That's awesome. When you think about before you came out of the womb of your mama, he already had plans for you. The problem is so many miss the plan. They miss the plan because they never found the calling. Never found the calling. So critical. I wrote a book called A Worker Need Not Be Ashamed. Came out in 2003. It's in 25,000 bookstores throughout the world. In chapter 1 of that book, I make the following statement right on the front. That the 2 most important days of your entire life is number 1, when you find out why God made you, okay? And then a 1 right there with it, both of them are number 1, when you come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. There's nothing that surpasses those 2 moments in your life, starting first with coming to Jesus, and secondly, finding out why he made you, because every person has a purpose. One of the activities that we do, a significant part of Worker Ministries, is living on the street with the homeless. New York City, Memphis, Tennessee, Charlotte, North Carolina, and Washington, D.C. I was working one day in Harlem in New York City, always there in January. By the way, I'm a cold weather buff. I love cold weather and can hardly wait till this coming January. We always do it in January in New York. So I'm in Harlem. It's about 31 degrees outside. And I'm standing there talking to a young man, I would say in his late 20s. I always like to test these folks. I want to find out if they have any kind of work ethic. And I will tell you that most of them would love to be employed. That's my report from the homeless. Okay? And so I gave a little test to this young man. I said, if I could give you $50,000 a year right now, would you go to work for me? And all of a sudden, I'm looking at his face, and there's nothing but tears coming down. And he said, Mister, and I'm quoting him right now, Mister, ain't nobody gonna hire me. I said, now, why is it that you would say that? He didn't say one word. He took his hands and brought them up in front of my face. He had no fingers. After I got myself together, I asked him, you know, what happened? He said, when I was 12 years old, I misbehaved Now, my mama threw me out on the street and told me never come back. I can repeat to you story after story of the homeless that I have met. And you just want to sit down and cry. But there's good news, and I delivered the good news to him. I said, sir, when God made you, he made somebody. You ain't no junk. He has a purpose for your life. But how in the world can I go to work and I don't have any fingers? I said, well, Ray Charles went to work and he didn't have any eyesight, and he was the most wonderful pianist you ever heard, especially when he played America the Beautiful. He and Kate Smith, you couldn't beat it. And then there was Helen Keller. Oh, and then there are those today who are sitting in wheelchairs that are working. I want to tell you something. You got to be pretty bad off to convince me you can't work. Because God put us here to work. He even said, if you don't work, you don't eat. That's scripture, folks. That's scripture, live and direct from the gospel. So you got to find your calling. Now, the question is, how do you find the calling? How do you find the calling? Well, let me interrupt this program immediately to bring you a special news bulletin. Since I used to work in broadcasting, I'll use that phrase, a late news bulletin. The message I'm about to say doesn't just apply to going to the workplace where you earn a living. It applies to inside a people's church. Find your calling. Find your calling. May I tell you about my calling? When I was 12 years old, or around 11, actually 11, my mother went to work for a radio station as a copywriter. She wrote all the commercials. And one day I said, Mama, would you please let me go with you to the radio station? Because by that time, since she worked in radio, I was listening to the radio, and I had a lot of curiosity. I wonder what a radio station looks like. I want to tell you something. She let me come to her with her to work, and I want to tell you, when I walked in that place, I got what they call, and it's an actual truth to this, there is a such thing as the radio bug. I will tell you that I fell in love with that business so much that I would have eaten a microphone, and I'll try to be careful not to eat this one. My goodness gracious. This is what I want to do in life. I want to work in broadcasting. And I even told her, would you please tell the radio manager, the one that you work for, could he give me a radio program? She says, son, you're too young. You're never too young. He actually said to her, yeah, I'll give him a radio program. Give him 30 minutes a week. 30 minutes a week, Saturday morning, 11:30 to 12. WHNC, Henderson, North Carolina, my hometown, about 70 miles up the road. I got a picture on our Worker Ministries website that shows me at the age of 12, boy, I'm having a ball, y'all. Got my earphones on, man, I'm on radio. Woo! And that's the way it was. Even through my teenage years, I'll tell you, I was so bad at it in terms of being in love with that business that someone said to my mother one day, I know that when you were pregnant with him, you looked at a blinking light on a radio tower. You had to. No question about it. I loved it. I loved the experience. I could tell that I'm gaining a lot of experience. And when I go off to school, I'm going to major in business administration. It'll be a good major because then I can use that to manage a radio station because I know that God's going to allow me to own a radio station. I had it, let me tell you. And then all of a sudden, when I was in school at East Carolina University, all of a sudden, something changed. In the first place, God often puts, as you already know, he many times puts special people in our life to help us. And in this case, it was an economic professor. Just something that drew me to this man and his teaching. I was in three of his different classes, three classes, made two B's and an A, praise God. Dr. Don Roeke. Something happened. I can't explain it totally. It doesn't have to be explained. But I'll tell you this, it was clear. God did not make me to work in broadcasting. You say, well, wait a minute, Jim, hold it. Why would he have you to work in it at a young age? I'll tell you exactly why. See, it's easy when you get older that you can look back on your life and see the truth. I'll tell you exactly why. He was giving me valuable experience that I would be able to transfer over to his calling for my life. And I will tell you what that calling was and still is. I am a teacher. I'm a teacher. And I've had a wonderful experience doing it. When I graduated from East Carolina University, I became a vocational teacher with the Granville County Schools in Oxford, North Carolina, next door to my hometown of Henderson, the other side of Durham. Wonderful 4 years with my precious students. I was placing them in on-the-job training at different locations. These are people didn't need to go to college. They were learning an occupation in high school in the afternoon. And one of the places I was placing the students was a company called Burlington Industries, which was the world's largest textile manufacturer. One day, they placed a telephone call to me, very strange. I want you to notice here, folks, how God works in a person's life. The telephone rings. Mr. Frank Bullock is a personnel manager there. He said, Jim, you know, you've placed students with us for the last 4 years. Have you ever thought about placing yourself? Well, see, I didn't get it. What you talking about? Why don't you come to work for us? I don't like moving around job to job. We got too much of that going on today. I said, I don't believe so. But to make a long story short, as I thought about the situation, especially when he said to me, you know, I don't want to take anything away from the school system. You come to work for Burlington Industries, you'll be able to train thousands of individuals, thousands. Well, that got my attention. Not that this that important numbers, but still being able to use your talents and abilities or whatever. And so I left the school system, and the day I did, I cried. It hurt me so badly to walk away from those students. Thank God for my students and the precious memories thereof. I still pray for them every day, the ones who are still alive. I went to work for Burlington Industries. I had a wonderful 32-year career. I became a corporate training director where I trained thousands of individuals. And then it was time in the year 2000 to leave the company, which I did. And that's when I started Worker Ministries. I couldn't believe it. I was talking to my sister about this the other day. I say, can you believe that I worked for Burlington Industries 32 years, even after I'd worked in broadcasting, and now beyond that, I have had 23 years in work of ministry. She says, well, I always said that you'd live two lives. I said, okay. I'm having real fun doing it too. Worker ministries, where I can go out and minister. One time I'm in New York City, the next time I'm in El Direct Canyon, Africa, spoke at a pastor's conference there in 2016. I'm just having a good time. You know, let me tell you something? When you find your calling there, you will find joy. You'll find joy because you see your ultimate boss is not the one who sits behind the desk in the office. He is number one. He is the report to you. The Bible says, work ye unto the Lord. He is the chairman of the board of Worker Ministries. I'm only the president and founder. We go according to his prescription, his way. Now, here's the problem before I leave the calling. The problem is that many people get confused between the word job and the word calling. I want to make a careful distinction of that this morning so you get your money's worth. In the first chapter of my book, A Worker Need Not Be Ashamed, I make that distinction, and here it is. The calling is why God puts you here. Okay? Now let me, in my case, he put me here, what? Teaching. Jim, I want you to teach all of your life. But you see, the job is the engine that drives the calling. You see the difference? The engine for me was actually starting off in broadcasting, getting that experience. And then it transferred over to the school system. And then it was Burlington Industries. And now it's Worker Ministries. That's the engine. But the calling has always been teacher. Teaching. That's the difference. That's very, very significant. Now, before I go any further, let me say this. And it'll be one of the most critical things that I say this morning. Folks, the calling again includes our, and I'm making this personal this morning, our church. God himself and Jesus himself said that the harvest will be great, but the workers will be few. I got a late news bulletin. The harvest is great at Peoples. And guess what? Another news bulletin. We need workers. We need those who don't just come in on Sunday morning and be what you call the Sunday morning Christian. We need those, and of course, I'm speaking to the choir because I'm looking out here at a lot of folks. They're already working for the Lord in this church, and God bless you. God bless you in the name of Jesus. But if you're not, that's why we gave a survey out several weeks ago asking folks to please let us know, what are your talents and ability? What would you love to do? We want you to enjoy it. What would you love to do in the house of the Lord for him and serving him? This message is not limited just to a job. Let me also say this, another news bulletin. I got a bunch of news bulletins this morning, as you can tell. And that is, this not just applies to those in this congregation who are parents. It applies to your children. The rest of what I say applies to your children. One of the major reasons why you'll be given a copy of this message this morning, we want you to take it and we want you to apply it. We want you to share it with your children. We want you to share it with the next door neighbor who hates to go to work tomorrow morning, or maybe they don't go tomorrow, it's Labor Day, but Tuesday, you know, I gotta go to that stinking job. They have no joy. They have no joy, none. It's just another job, and I'll just be so glad when I can retire and go to Myrtle Beach. We'll tell you more about Myrtle Beach later, okay? I'm getting a little bit wound up, as you can tell, this morning. We need to share this. We'll talk about that a little more later. Number one, how to live a purpose-driven life. Find your calling. Find your calling. Everyone has one. Number two, prepare for the calling. Prepare. Now, that's pretty logical, isn't it? If I go to a job, to work a job, hopefully I'll be trained. Let me say this to you. If you work for, you workers and go out in the workplace, if you work today for an organization that has a training program, who train their employees, you are blessed. You are blessed. That's why I was so blessed to work for Burlington Industries. They supported everything I did for 32 years because they knew the importance of training employees. After all, how can you expect an employee to do the job right if you do not train them? You must train them. Train them. So that's important. Training for the job. Even in the church sometimes, we need training. Probably need more training for our people. Training for the leaders. Training for whoever. Otherwise, you begin to go down a sort of a dead-end path, you know, and all of a sudden you have trouble, like you make a mistake on the job. Well, you know, nobody ever told me that. Nobody ever told me this. But let me also tell you this, and let me be very careful with what I say now. Not only do you and I need training for the job, let me tell you right now, we need some more training. And I brought my textbook for that training this morning. It's known as God's Word. In this day and age we live in, you know, when I used to come to church, Miss Nancy and Brother Allman and others would be on this pulpit, and they'd be talking about the breastplate and protection of yourself against the sins. I've got to admit to you this morning, it really didn't mean that much to me, but I'm going to tell you right now, the United States of America has moved from a Christian nation to a heathen nation, and you don't know what you're going to face out there when you're working for God. You need to be prepared. Prepared. Put on the breastplate. Let me give you an example. A lot of folks, you may be some of them, I don't know, are aware of the fact that it's part of my ministry. I bumped into something some years ago that was another medium. It's amazing how God places things in your life, mediums, and in other words, ways to spread the gospel. All of a sudden, I discovered this local radio program called Talkline. On WBAG, 1150 on your radio dial. Every morning it runs from 8:30 to 10:30, where people can call in and they're given 5 minutes of free time to express their views. And so now I will warn you ahead of time, if you ever listen to the program now, it's got a lot of politics, that's okay. That's okay. Christians are supposed to go into that arena. See, we got people in this country today that tell Christians, no, you don't need to talk about politics. You just need to keep your mouth shut and go over and sit in the corner the rest of your life, and then we'll take you to the cemetery. I've actually had people to tell me that. We need to be prepared because Christians are being attacked in this country, as you know. Give me an example. Had a caller to call in at WBAG one morning. This Hogsit guy that calls in, by the way, he nicknamed me Hogwash. This Hogwash guy that calls in, you know, and he's talking about sexual sins that are being addressed in the Old Testament. He don't know what he's talking about. The Old Testament is no longer relevant to the times in which we're living. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that's not coming out of my New York City, which is my second home place. It's not coming out of Memphis, Tennessee. It's coming out of little old Burlington, North Carolina. They're here, right here, ready to attack you. So my question to you this morning is this. Are you prepared to respond? Be very careful. Jesus said that he doesn't care for lukewarm Christians, that he could spit them out of his mouth. Be very careful. Well, I'm a little nervous. Well, you don't have to get on the radio. You do whatever makes you comfortable. But let me tell you this, don't get so comfortable that you won't respond. That person needed a response. You say, what did you say? I got on the radio and this is what I said to him. The caller who just called needs to understand one thing. That the Old Testament, all the way from the beginning of Genesis and all the way through the New Testament, is about one individual named Jesus Christ. And it's addressed as early as the early chapter in Genesis. Jesus is the one for which this book has been written. So we can subscribe to his teachings all the way through. And then I said this. If the Old Testament is not relevant to the times in which we're living, then why is it that in the New Testament that Jesus often refers to Scripture in the Old Testament, he often refers to Moses, to Isaiah, and what have you. And we know that as Christians, don't we? But I also decided that, sir, if you're not convinced in what I'm saying about sexual sins that are being addressed in the Old Testament, if there's something about that, sir, that's bothering you, I would suggest that you go to the New Testament and you will find Jesus Christ quoting the same scripture that against sexual sins, even to the extent of saying that if you're homosexual, when you die, you will go to hell. Now, he may not like that, but I delivered it. Now, we got to be careful how we deliver such a message. Love the sinner, but hate the sin. You don't do any of this through vengeance. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Vengeance doesn't belong to us. But folks, we have to be careful here to understand the difference in what I'm talking about. Because you see, when it comes to some of these sins, the first thing that the sinner will say is, God loves, God loves. They will even tell you that God would never send anybody to hell. And by the way, they happen to be correct about that. He has never sent anybody to hell. You send yourself to hell because that's the choice you make. You say, well, I want to tell you one thing, Jim, but some folks are not going to like what you're saying. I'm sorry. It's based on his word. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Prepare for the calling. Before I leave, number two, remember, number one is to find your calling. Number two, prepare for the calling. Let me tell you a beautiful story, a true story. One of my students in Oxford that I taught named Reeves Hicks. Okay? Guess what? Before I placed him in his job assignment, I would actually require them to go through an interview. I wanted them to get used in the real world. You know, you have to be interviewed by the boss to find out if you're going to get the job. So I did that with my students. So I simply asked him the question. I was even asking the question back then, what do you want to do with your life? Of course, what I'm referring to is a calling. What do you want to do with your life? Where he looked at me just as serious. He said, Mr. Hogg said, I want to be a funeral director and embalmer. Excuse me one moment. What did you say? I want to be a funeral director. Who on God's earth would want to be a funeral director and embalmer? Are you kidding me? Are you sure? He was just as seriously 16 years old. 16. He was serious. I could tell it. I said, now you do realize that you're a junior in high school. You'll be a junior next year. So if I place you in the funeral home to learn on-the-job training through being a funeral director, okay, you're required to be there 2 years. We don't have any job hopping to take place. Are you committed? You bet he was committed. Now, understand this. He did need to go to bombing school for a year. We couldn't teach him in bombing, but the rest of it, we took care of that in high school. And then after he graduated, he went to school for a year. Now, here's what I'm saying. I'm saying several things here, folks. We got too many parents out here, too many folks out here that are telling young people, well, you've got to go to college. You've got to go to college. Got to get a four-year degree or you won't amount to nothing. Give me a break. No way, Jose. You know what dictates the education? The calling. Now, I had to go to school 5 years in order to get that teaching certificate I had, in addition to the business degree and economics degree. I had to do all that. But that was me. That was my calling, teaching. The plumber who serviced me last year for 30 minutes, he drove up into my driveway. He had to repair a leaking faucet. You don't need a four-year degree. And evidently, he's making plenty of money. I know this. He charged me $150 for 30 minutes. I'd say that's pretty good pay. And God bless him. God bless him for repairing my faucet. Be very careful. But let's continue my story of my funeral director. It was so beautiful. Because after he went to embalming school, he came back to Oxford, North Carolina, and worked at the funeral home. And the next thing, I kept up with him, Jerry. The next thing I knew, just not long after that, somebody said to me, Jim, guess what? Your little funeral director now owns his own funeral home. Praise God. Praise God. And I want to tell you, 35 years later, he buried my mama. That's the way you do it, Reeves. That's the way you do it. Find your calling. Prepare for the calling. Yes. Yes. Do you understand why I'm delivering this message this morning, folks? This is critical. This message is critical. Not because I'm delivering it, because God placed this on my heart long ago. The world needs to understand how to live a purpose-driven life. Number three on my list this morning. You must exercise your responsibilities in a godly manner. Now, that one shouldn't surprise you. That one shouldn't surprise you. It was William Shakespeare who once upon a time said, all of the world is a stage, and the people are only actors. Now, I really don't agree with that aspect of it related to us Christians. We're not put here to act. But I'm going to tell you this morning. You and I are on the stage. And I want to tell you who's looking at us, the world. The world is looking at us. The unsaved are looking at us. What kind of life do we live? Not only in the workplace, what kind of life do you live in raising up your children? What kind of life do you live inside of this church? Because after all, a church has a reputation that goes to the community. That's right. What kind of life are we living? What kind of life are we living? Oh, my goodness. I do love my role models. My role models, the names that I call out to you this morning have had a positive impact on my life so much that I continue to call them. I could call many names. Time does not permit for all of them, but I want to give you a few examples. How about that precious gentleman? I look forward to meeting him in heaven. Oh, dear God, I do, because he's the one who down in Atlanta, Georgia, started that little restaurant down there called the Dwarf Grill, and he invented a famous recipe. My goodness. But do you know what he did before he started his first restaurant? He sat down and took a sheet of paper and a pen and pencil, and he wrote out 10 promises to God. I want to tell you something. I've never done that in my life. I think it probably be a good exercise for us to do it sometime. Because I'll tell you this, when you write out the promises on the piece of paper, you better keep them. And he did. One of the promises that he wrote out was the fact that, dear God, I promise to you, regardless of what happens. Remember, he hasn't even opened the restaurant yet in Atlanta. Hadn't opened the door yet. But I promise you, when I do, I will never open my restaurant on Sunday. Yeah. And the next thing you knew, he had two restaurants. Then he had three. Then he had four. When he died, he owned 2,000 plus restaurants in North Carolina, in this country, over 2,000 Chick-fil-A's, and he was worth $1.9 billion. His name was Truett Cathy. I'll tell you one thing. When I get to heaven, I want to run over to that man, and I want to say two things to him. Brother Cathy, first of all, thank you for that delicious sausage, egg, and cheese biscuit Chick-fil-A that I enjoy. And number two on my list is, above all, thank you for the Christian example that you set for me that has helped me in my life. Thank you, Mr. Cathy. Thank you. Praise God for such individuals as this. And then there's the case of the individual who became my mentor. He is my mentor, and he always will be. Because he taught me how to defend the gospel. He taught me the kind of faith and trust that I need to have in God Almighty. He taught me that. He taught me that. Oh, talk about a calling. Talk about a calling. He went off to college to be an engineer. And God changed his mind too. Don't want you to be an engineer. I want you to be a preacher. When he came back to his hometown after going to Bible school, he decided, I'm going to start a church. He rented a place called the Donald Duck Bottling Company building. It had dirt floor. He went to a man in downtown that was closing out a theater. He was going to remodel his theater. And he was pulling out all the seats. And the pastor said, if you're not going to use those seats, would you sell them to me? He said, I'm not going to sell them to you. You can have them as long as you've got somebody can transport them. He said, well, I'll get somebody to transport them. He got a truck and transported every one of them to the Donald Duck Bottling Company building. And he set them up inside of that building, and he started his church. And one year after he started that church, he had 1,000, can you imagine that? 1,000 members already of that church. Today, over 25,000 members at Thomas Road Baptist Church, founded by Dr. Jerry Falwell. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Praise God for the life that man lived. He went through a pure living hell in so many of the things he did, but he persevered because you see, he was a Christian worker. He knew his purpose for living. He had found the calling. He had prepared, and now he's exercising that calling. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. He made one mistake. When he decided, I'm going to start a Bible college. It started off as Lynchburg Bible College. In the Sunday school rooms of the Thomas Road Baptist is where he started. And he rented some houses across the street as a dormitories for the students. But he made one little boo-boo. He said, God, I'm praying to you that this will eventually become a Christian university. And you'll send me 50,000 students. Did you know that when you find your calling that you have, that many times that God will surpass your wildest dreams? Today, over 100,000 students reside in that university. Praise the Lord. Praise God. It could only happen because of the hand of God. Yeah. Liberty University. Ooh. I do love to visit that place. I go there often. I've spoken there, in fact, at Liberty University, and I just love the atmosphere and everything that's located there connected with that university. Praise the Lord. Oh, by the way, as part of my calling and work of ministries, I also and it's just for one concern because my schedule won't permit otherwise, but I actually train all of the drivers who work for Alamance County Transportation Authority. I've done that also for 23 years, and they transport folks around. You've seen them, the little white buses that go around town. They pick up folks in the wheelchairs. Oh, yeah, they have to go through an extensive training program, and I is their instructor, okay? And toward the end of their training, I will then take them out on the road, or they go out on the road, and I'm sitting in the back. I had to evaluate their performance to determine if I can cut them loose from the training program, and then they're able to go alone and so forth. Very important, very important. And so one day we're picking up a lady in a wheelchair, and he delivers her to the house. He's doing a great job. I'm watching him right now. Let me tell you, remember, I was a corporate training director, and I want to tell you, when I train somebody, I look at every square inch of what you're doing. Do the job right. God put you here to do the job right. Do the job right the first time. No excuses. We got too many people in this world making excuses in the workplace about work. Do the job right. Just like they do at my village grill that served me that tuna last night. They do such a wonderful, I got off the subject there. Okay, all right, do the job right. So he brought out the lift. Remember, he's bringing her home, to her home, okay? So he has to put her on a lift, and the lift goes down from the van, and then he pushes her off the lift and pushes her to her back door, and then she goes inside. Do you know something? And he's a trainee now. He's a trainee. You know something? When he came back to the van, he did something I thought a little strange at first till I figured out what was going on. She had a trash barrel that was on the street that belonged to her. I saw him go over and open it up, and I thought, what is he doing opening up the trash barrel? He wanted to see if anything was in it. He determined it had been emptied, and he took the trash barrel and he rolled it back to her back door so that it would be taken off the street. But ladies and gentlemen of People's Church, that's not in his job description. No, he went outside of his job description. He did more than what was expected. He's using his talents and abilities to do more, because he recognizes that he himself could be the one that's sitting in that wheelchair. He certainly could. And I want to tell you, some of the people that are picked up in that organization, not only on a wheelchair, they don't even have feet and legs. Bad news. Bad news. If you want to see a case of needs or whatever, go into Alamance County Transportation Authority and see what I see with my human eyes. It is pitiful. But he went the extra mile. Have you ever heard somebody say in the workplace, well, it's good enough? I want to tell you something. When it comes to God Almighty and the talents and abilities he's given me, it is never good enough. Never. It is never good enough. We're to do our God-given best to the best of our God-given ability. It's never, 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 never good enough. Working unto the Lord. And you see, that should be our motivation. Our motivation for living this kind of life comes from up there. That if I recognize that even if I've got the meanest boss in the world, I'm working for God. And that will motivate me to the nth degree, and it does me. Even when that guy gets on the radio and lays this blasphemy against me, I can take it, baby. I have no difficulties with that whatsoever. And I'll tell you more about that just before we close, okay? We're talking this morning how to live a purpose-driven life. Number one, find your calling. Find your calling. Number two, prepare for the calling. Number three, exercise your calling. By following God's plan and living a godly life, living a Christian life, let others see Jesus through you. Number four, oh boy, watch this one. I'm going to be careful. I don't want anybody to throw any apples or oranges at me. Even in God's house, it could happen. Never, 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 never retire. Well, I can't believe he said that. You mean I came to church this morning to hear this guy say never? Yeah, absolutely, you sure did, and thank you for being here. Never retire. You say, can you give me two good reasons? I'll be glad to. Number one, you can open this book, our textbook for living, God's Word, and I will guarantee you, you will not see one word called retirement. It ain't there. And I'll tell you why it's not there, okay? I could give you several reasons. One is the fact that when God made us, he didn't make us to retire. But I'm going to take it one step further. You know what I said to him this morning when I was praying to him about 6:45 this morning? I said, Dear God, thank you not only for Jesus, but Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you did not retire on us before you went to the cross. Do I hear amen? Thank you. We're getting hot here this morning. Whew. Now, let me be careful. There's no problem in going to Myrtle Beach or wherever you want to go. I don't go to the beach that much because I'm not a hot weather person. I like when I'm sitting out in New York City, it's 15 degrees out there, whatever, you know I'm okay. But you can imagine if it's 95. Anyway, sure, you can take your vacations. God wants you to. He wants you to rest. One of the shortest verses in the entire Bible states, Jesus rested. Because he was a human in human form. He was also God, but also in human form. He needed a rest. I'll tell you a little secret. Studies have shown that when you rest, you will have much more productivity in your life. Just take a break and get away from it. I found that through my own experience. That if I just take a break and rest. Now, let me be careful with this. You said, wait a minute, Jim, hold on a minute. When you left Burlington Industries, what about that one? Didn't you retire? I retired from Burlington Industries, but I did not retire from life. Do you see the difference? Oh, that's so misunderstood. Do you see it? Please grab hold of that. I didn't retire on God. Just as soon, actually, before I left Burlington, I was already doing two things, okay? I was setting up for Work of Ministries. It took about 3 or 4 years to get that done. This is a massive undertaking. This is a worldwide organization. But number two, guess what else I was doing? I went to the community college to study to be a CNA, a certified nursing assistant, and guess what I did for 6 years? This is 2000, starting 2000. I went to a place called Blakey Hall in Elon, and I served the elderly there. That's right. I served the elderly there. So therefore, I was able to minister to them using my talents and abilities, and then, of course, now I'm full-time, you know, with Work of Ministries. So my point in this is God wants us to rest, but not retire from life. We're to live, because that's not a purpose-driven life. Retirement is not a purpose-driven life. And if you'll notice, there are many people who hung it up. You know, that's the favorite expression. I had one that come to me the other day. You still working? You know, like it's poison. You still working? Yeah. Well, when are you going to hang it up? Let me move on, folks, or my blood pressure will go up. I don't want to be careful. Living a purpose-driven life. Number one on the list, find your calling. Number two, prepare for the calling. Number three, exercise that calling. Number four, never retire on God. Let me give you number five. And number five is sort of kin to number four. Do not become a workaholic. I had to slip that in, folks, because the way I'm talking about this subject of work sounds like when I'm supposed to, this guy was supposed to say he's supposed to work 24 hours a day. That's a workaholic. That's a workaholic. And again, it ties right in with what I just said about Jesus. Jesus rested. He rested, okay? And that includes on the Sabbath, I might add, okay? And so my point is, workaholic is dangerous. It's an addiction. It's like alcohol. And it can tear down your body. And see, the body that God has given us, hey, that's the temple. That's the temple that God, we're supposed to take care of it and not dishonor it. And that includes other things. And you can talk about your diet or whatever and getting good exercise. And all of those things are our responsibility to take. And you see, if we take care of ourselves, you know, the longer we can live, if it's his purpose for us to continue to live. So that we can do the work that I'm talking about and live a long and healthy life or whatever. That's what we would all hope for. Well, I'm telling you how to do it this morning, living a purpose-driven life. And then finally, number six on the list. Number six, and never forget this. In fact, if you want to put this at number one, I perfectly understand. What's number six, Jim? To God be the glory. I have shared with you this morning in this message some of my own personal accomplishments, only for the purpose of giving you some examples here this morning, not to brag on me, because I don't need any bragging about me, that's for sure. That is for sure. To God be all the glory. You know what I said to him this morning when I was praying? Thank you, Heavenly Father, for all the talents and abilities you've given me. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for every door you've opened and every door you've closed, because you know what is best. You know what's behind that closed door that could hurt me. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for precious souls that you placed in my pathway that enables me to do the work that I've been able to do. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the excellent health that you've given me. Thank you for every day that I'm able to wake up and come out of that bed, praise God, in Jesus' name. For all of the opportunity. You see, you could go on and on and on. It's to God be the glory. He gets the credit for everything I've talked about. When you find your calling, when you fulfill it, he gets all of the credit. To God be the glory. May we never forget that. And may we never forget in all of this that we would be faithful. Miss Cindy this morning in the Sunday school class that we have here. And by the way, we need to get some more folks in that Sunday school class back there. She teaches one Sunday, I teach another. Pat's done some teaching over there. Need to have that, okay? We invite you to be there. But this morning I picked up something very significant out of the many things that she talked about in the lesson when she made this statement. God is going to be faithful to us. Are we going to be faithful to him? This morning, I have told you how to be faithful to him. He'll take care of you. Just through describing my own life, you'll notice how God entered my life, how he pulled me out of that radio station and put me in teaching, how he put me in the Pasadena Convention Center to minister to precious folks in California out there. All he's done for me, the wonderful people in Times Square that I met as I spoke in Times Square, I'm planning to do it again too, probably in 2025. Speaking in New York City, one of my favorite places, believe it or not. No, I'm not scared one bit. Not one bit, because God is with me. But you know, it was funny that I'm up there on the platform and I'm speaking in Times Square and this guy walks up in front of me or whatever, and he comes up with his hand like that. I figure, oh, here we go. He gonna hit me just as sure as you're born. He comes over there, and this is what he does, John. He takes his hand and he gives me a high five. You know what he's saying? I agree with you, buddy, on what you just said. Yeah, and you know what I said to him? Praise God for you, brother. Thank you. I interrupted what I said there in Times Square, right in the middle of Times Square where there are thousands of people. Oh, boy. Man, I'm laying the word on. Because God told me to. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Now, with that in mind, I want us to close this morning with one of my favorite hymns. That says so much. We'll just sing one verse of it. It'll be in your hymn book, and I believe that's, let me double check the number there. It is number 139. I don't care whether you stand or you sit, but what I do care about, do we sing? All about God and his faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. I'm not a good singer, so I need for you to take hold here.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou
God, praise God, praise God. You know, I just feel really compelled just to add one more of my heroes to my list this morning. I am so blessed. When I came to Burlington, North Carolina, and this is back, I came here in 1976, but it had to be in the early 80s that God placed somebody in my pathway. And I just have to call his name in just a second. Would you believe it's my medical doctor? I will tell you, I can't believe the number of times when I've gone there for annual physical And Jerry, we sat there and talked about Jesus more than I did my human body. He's that kind of doctor. Have you got a Christian doctor? I have. I noticed something this past week. I've never noticed it before. I happened to be on the website for Burlington Family Practice where he's located. And if you click on his picture and it goes to the information about him, at the bottom of it is one line. I believe that Jesus put me here to help others. Man. You wonder why I get excited about delivering a message like this? You just heard it. Hope you'll tune in on the radio and listen to more if you get the opportunity or whatever. And to be careful, because it ain't going to be fun when you listen to that radio program, okay? They're coming after you. Now this morning, I want to close with three items, and we'll be out of here. And thank you again so much for being here this morning. Praise God. First of all, the handout, I promise. Miss Pat and Miss Cindy, they're going to give you a copy, and I'm going to give them time to give you a copy of this. And while they're giving you that copy, I'm going to give you an assignment, okay? An assignment. Don't you love that? You come to class, you got to get an assignment. I want you to take this home, and I want you to read it. Everything I've talked about is right there on four pages. Read it. Think about it. Massage it. Think about your own life, not just out there where you earn a living. Think about it as related to this church. Am I serving God through my church? Because Jim reminded me that it's not just about where you make your living. It's anywhere that you're serving him, anywhere. Take it and digest it. Oh, parents, loved ones, and grandparents, and Don't miss sharing this message and this truth with those young people, especially those who don't know what they want to do. Now, I'll tell you this, don't be fooled. Many young people do know what they want to do. I've met five-year-olds early in life that are now doing what they wanted to do. They dreamed of being a doctor or whatever, and it came to pass. Let them dream their dreams. Now, God may change that, but you need to get them on the path of thinking about what they're going to do with this life. So they're not wanderers in the wilderness that I speak of in my book. They need to have purpose, living a purpose-driven life. So please do that, okay? Number two on my assignment list, giving you an assignment this morning, okay? Please be back next week, okay? Adam will be our speaker for next Sunday morning, please. But I'm going to add to that one item. Please, bring one person with you. Bring one person with you to this service. That's how you start filling these people. Now you say, no, wait a minute, Jim, what if I ask somebody to come and they don't come? That's okay. God has already checked you off in heaven. He's already given you credit. He's got his initials beside you. You made the effort, but when you don't make the effort, he holds us responsible. Bring at least one person. It could be a homeless person that you keep seeing. Bring him in here. We can get him cleaned up. I'll tell you a little secret about most of the homeless folks I've met. They're not that nasty anyway. It may surprise you that's the case. They're fine places to get a bath. But my point is, bring someone with you, please. And then number three, 2 weeks from this morning, they've asked me to speak again. I'm going to give you the title of the topic already so that you can be prepared, okay? I don't want you to be shocked when you come in. 2 weeks from this morning, I will speak on this subject, how to deal with difficult people in the workplace, in the family, and in the church. Woo! Good gracious. Okay? That's 2 weeks from this morning, how to deal with difficult people in the workplace, and in the family, and in the church. Anybody got anything they want to say before we leave the house of the Lord? Yes, sir.
And then finally, I just want to invite everyone here to come afterwards. We're going to have a meeting up front. It's going to be about the future of the children's ministry. My wife, Jen, and Ashley Thompson has been working very hard on trying to produce a really exciting program for the kids, for our youth. And I'm excited about it. I think it's going to be a really good thing, and that's one of the purposes we need to be, is training up the next generation. And like Jim was talking about, such a good message about the call. So just please, if you could come forward, if you feel like you want to get involved in something, it may not be teaching, you just want to help watch kids play kickball, hey, we need those people too. We really actually don't need as many teachers as we need just folks to help and get excited about being there with the kids. We are going to have a great kids program and youth program. I want you to be a part of it. So if you could just come up front right after the service, and we'll look forward to talking more about that then. So,
yes, even if you don't want to serve, I want you to know what's going to go on, because it's going to be a little different. It will be a program, and there's a lot of things to talk about. So even if you don't want to serve, I just want to meet with everyone up to the front. It'll take 5 minutes. I'm going to pass out some papers and do that. So thank you.
All right. I'll close in prayer. Father, we just thank you so much today for giving us life, Father. We thank you for the call that you've put on our hearts to follow you and to follow Jesus as our Savior. Pray that you just help us to embrace that call, Father. Thank you for Brother Jim, who brought the message that you've put on his heart. I pray that you continue to bless his ministry. And for everyone that's here, that you would just stir in their hearts, Father, what you've laid on them whenever you first called them to follow you. And that you would just build that up, Father, and that we could be used to glorify you as we walk out into this world. Pray that you bless people's church as we go forth from here, Father. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.